So there's this guy, his name's Uber Boyo, and he's one of these Nietzscheans. He's one of these Nietzsche guys, and he hates Christianity. And so I want to watch one of his videos on here. It says, "Exploring Nietzsche's brutal criticism of Christianity." So you guys want to watch this? We can watch Exploring Nietzsche's brutal criticism of
So here.
Christianity. Let's go. Okay. Turn off the music. Let's turn up the audio so you guys can hear the video. We'll get into it. Let's get into it.
Been having chats with lots of Christians recently, Mr. Church of Eternal Logos, Mr. Classical Theist, and various other Christians across the internet spectrum. And one of the big memetic problems right now is deciding if we Western people are going to follow Nietzsche, the incel who lived on a mountain with his magic prophecy of lightning and Zarathustra, if we're going to follow him, if he's the way that we're going to reach salvation in this world, or if we must go back to Christianity.
Go
We must go
back,
back.
we go back, nigga. It's
Back not
we're
to
going
Jordan
forward to
Peterson archetype
Christianity.
Christianity. No, we must go back to the real deal. Christ is
Go
Lord. Christ
back,
is the real deal.
go back, nigga. Go back to what? We're going forward. We're going up. We're transcending time. We're transcending boundaries. It's eternal life. We don't have a back. We only have forward. Eternal.
Christ is not just a hero in a myth. Christ is the actual manifestation of the divine ordering principle that holds the world together.
Yeah,
And if you believe in
exactly.
him, all the beautiful things that you're looking for will come. And if you don't believe in him, you will turn into a scammer. You will turn into a nasty man. You will do all sorts of terrible things.
It's true. It's true.
You will end up watching porn all day. You'll end up
It's true.
growing blue hair. You won't even
It's literally true, though.
have to diet. You'll end up getting man boobs. You'll end up just
Yes. Yes. It literally happens.
starting to develop these tinglings inside your tongue, which are like, get me more Soylent. I need more Soylent running down my throat because I don't believe in Christ. This is where the rubber is hitting the road. So which way forward, Western man? Which way are we going to go? Now, in order to explore this, allow me to bring you back to Jordan Peterson. You see, when I was growing up, the spiritual hegemon was Richard Dawkins and Sam Harris and his meditation classes. And these were the four horsemen of atheists, alongside some other guy, Dillahunty, was it? And I don't know, Hitchens, I don't know, some dude. Anyway, these dudes
Yeah, and
were
you're like
telling us
still
that.
trapped up in it. You're still trapped up in their like fucking matrix, their mental prison that you're in.
God was non-existent. It was all just this irrational cope, and we should all pursue well-being, and we should all understand that the premises of modern liberal society are absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, and you're still in this mind prison.
Of course. And this was the world hegemon. And Jordan Peterson showed up and bucked this trend. He was one of the first people ever to popularize a perspective that was against that way of seeing the world. He was the first person to come in and make God cool once again. Now, his approach was he comes in very Jungian. He's talking about Jungian archetypes. He's talking about how Christianity and religion has an evolutionarily psychological relevancy. It's really something that makes sense 100% when you think about it. And he has all these stories about how the Bible is like a psychological document and whatnot. And he's doing something very interesting and very important. He's showing us how the field of psychology is able to modernize what the purpose of religion was. You know, where he's helping us understand the reason we had religion and how religion actually contained immense amounts of value in it.
Yeah, that's something that I hate about Jordan Peterson. Is Jordan Peterson doesn't like even actually understand Christianity. I do not understand how anyone who is a Christian, because again, every time I talk so badly about Jordan Peterson, hundreds of people jump down my throat. How dare you say that about Jordan Peterson? He's a Christian. He's going to be and it's like why do you guys like Jordan Peterson so much? Jordan Peterson does not believe God is real. And even more than that, he doesn't even understand what the core tenets of Christianity is. So, like, Jordan Peterson's understanding of Christianity is that Christianity isn't real, God's not real, there is no spiritual realm. That the spiritual realm is actually just an ancient understanding of the psychological realm. And ancient people just had no ability to distinguish between the psychological mental realm. Like, show the other cat. Send in a super chat and I'll show you the other one. So anyways, shut up, Frazier. Frazier, be quiet. Calm down. But so he believes that, you know, basically all this talk about angels and all this talk about God, it's just representing like archetypes in your mind. It's just representing like mental illnesses. And demons are mental illnesses. And angels are like good ideas that help you improve your lives and shit like that. And it's like, dude, I swear, man, calm the fuck down. So, you know, this is what Jordan Peterson believes. That's what Christianity's about. Christianity, I would say, is more atheist than atheism. If you actually read the Bible, the Bible's like super, it's anti-superstition. If you read the Bible, it's literally, it is, if you read the Bible, the whole Bible is very, is like anti-religious. God hates religion. Like, and when I say religion, I'm talking about like, you know, having these crystals, having these like relics that we use in worship and like, you know, bowing down to statues and all this kind of stuff like that. God hates that stuff. God doesn't want us to, you know, pray. I mean, maybe the Catholics in here are going to hate me. God doesn't want us to pray the rosary. God doesn't want us to, you know, do all this like stupid shit. Do these religious rituals. God does not like rituals. He hates rituals. That's all superstition. What Christianity is about fundamentally, it's about rejecting rituals and receiving real actual power. Instead of doing these counterfeit magic rituals that basically all they do are they're just placebo affecting yourself into, you know, having something happen, using the placebo effect to make yourself happy, using the placebo effect to get rid of your pain. That's what these rituals do. What God is offering is like actual supernatural experience, an actual supernatural power. What Christianity is offering is legitimate, real supernatural power, where you can directly ask God to give you something and it'll happen. You can directly ask God to heal you and it will happen. You can directly ask God to tell you something, give you an answer, and he'll tell you that. Someone wants to read your recommendation. I don't see that. I don't see your recommendation. It's not on here. So, anyways. So I hate Jordan Peterson because he portrays himself as being this knowledgeable, trustworthy source of information on Christianity, but he does not even acknowledge what Christianity is actually teaching. Christianity does not merely just teach you psychological tricks to make yourself feel better and be able to cope better with the modern world. Christianity is about God's going to literally intervene and supernaturally change you into a better person without any input of your own. These are two different things. Okay? The message of the Bible is like very clear. The Bible says is very clear about that. It's not this metaphorical thing. There is no metaphor. It's literal. there's no way you can interpret John 3:16 that we just read earlier as being just metaphorical.
And of course, this shocks the atheists, because the atheists were saying, oh, well, you know, religion is behind us and all this. And that's all good. That stirs them up a little bit. Their knickers get in a twist. Reddit goes into crisis as a consequence of this. But there's something more important that happens at this point. Because he comes up and he starts to red pill people.
Guys, the cat
what Nietzsche was saying. He begins to introduce people to Jung, to Christianity, and to Friedrich Nietzsche. And this is very, very fantastic, because these are unbelievably massive worldviews and ways of thinking. And he's constantly lamenting and talking about this problem of God is dead. And when I was listening to Jordan Peterson, he was opening my mind up to the fact that all might not be well in the state of Denmark. Around about this time as well, you had Trump show up. Now, Trump is so fascinating, because Trump goes up and he says that Western Europeans, Western people in the West, in America specifically, they are getting bullied by these liberals that don't actually like them, that they're exploiting them, that are turning them into losers and dorks and failures. And Trump was like, we Western people, we should win. We should not move, you know, our entire infrastructure over to China, and we should not lose. Let's stop losing, and let's start putting ourselves our best foot forward and start winning. And this seems kind of like bombastic and crude and arrogant to people. But when the more you start to look at it, the more you start to see it making sense. Because Western people treat themselves as losers. We have this guilt complex where we think that we're the demons that ruined all of the world and all of existence. And the only right way that we can carry ourselves going forward is we must destroy our civilization, hand our civilization over to other people, and ruin our freedom and our quality of life for the sake of the environment and all these types of things. So this is all very, very interesting stuff. Now, wrapped up in this as well is Jordan Peterson coming in and saying that there's a load of communists in the institutions that are trying to brainwash you into enjoying Marxism. Now, that sounds crazy to people, but I remember I dropped out of college and very unconsciously. I was in college and they were trying to teach me all this stuff, and I felt it was not really helping me fulfill my potential as a man. I was a young man and I wanted to be juicy. I wanted to be strong. I wanted to be a capable speaker. I wanted to be charismatic, creative. I wanted to have skills and competency and power. I wanted to express myself. But I found when I was in college, the place that I thought I would go to get educated and they would fix me and make me better and make me more powerful. Instead, I found that they were like an old biblical preacher, you know, smashing books on my head. Marxism, Judah Butler, queer theory, all these type of things. And they were haggarding me and giving out to me about this stuff. Annoying, sort of saying, men are evil.
I hate you.
Western men, phallogocentrism, white men are awful, terrible things and all this. And they were trying to turn me into a book sell, a book coper, a theory sell, making me read like Foucault and stuff like this. And I remember I just said, this is crap. I'm not learning any skills. Maybe the knowledge is interesting, but I'm not learning any skills. I'm out of here. And so I dropped out. I took Plato, I took Nietzsche, I took these guys, I took Jung, and I read them myself and all this stuff. Now, Jordan Peterson shows up later and starts to talk about Nietzsche and Jung. I'm like, oh, fantastic.
Yeah,
the only man in the world who's talking about these things that I found so interesting. He's talking about them. And then he starts to remind me, he's like saying, yo, these neo-Marxists have taken over the universities. And it's like a light bulb goes off. I'm like, wait a second. They were trying to teach me Marxism. What? Oh my God, I've been through this. Holy Lord. The critical theory, the feminist theory, all this stuff.
Send in super chats. The only thing that will be able to get me through this fucking video is if you send me super chats.
God, I'm so lucky that I escaped that trap. That's so fantastic. And then he goes to point out something astounding. You know, he says that Western culture is in a crisis right now. And I'm like, what? Really? I thought we were fine, you know? Is it not supposed to be? But he's like, no. Like, we're actually in a really, really bad place for many reasons. And I started to look around. It was like, you know, when somebody says, there's purple cars in this city. And you're like, what, really? And then you walk outside and you just start to see them everywhere. Now, of course, they were always there, but you didn't notice them because someone hadn't trained your perceptions to look. So he says that God is dead. And I start to think about my life and I'm like, wait a second, yeah. Like, my grandmother's super Catholic, you know, absolutely loved the church and all this. And I remember growing up and just Catholicism was not really in the schools at all and stuff like that. We did stuff like our communion and we had like religious studies, but most people I knew were sort of atheist. I grew up in Ireland. People would always make fun of God and make fun of the Bible and call it silly. Everybody in Ireland thinks the priests are all pedophiles now. There's all those scandals that came out and all this type of stuff. And so the Christianity had sort of been pushed out of the picture. And at the same time, there was this attitude that everything that Christianity represented in the past was bad and all these type of things, you know, like the sexual restrictions.
Are you gonna jump off again
and all these types of things. And the whole idea now is that we're all free. You get to like have sex with everybody and it's absolutely great. And you're free to do whatever you want. You can go pursue your pleasures and all this. And
Nietzscheans like framing themselves in a much more prominent position than they have. They're in no way second line to Christianity. In the right wing, they definitely are.
Someone like Jordan Peterson shows up, many people around him, and says, well, this was actually a consequence of God dying. The symbol of God
John Doyle's
loses its vital force.
Vince Dow's
and this leads
a
us in a very
David
dangerous
Carlson's
situation. Why? Because
Nietzschean.
Actually many things are going wrong.
Now, I mean, like,
for example,
do those guys all suck?
Like, we're not
like,
forming
no one,
families anymore.
No
that leads
even,
to
like,
us not being able to raise
are.
Strong children.
Yeah,
which leads
like,
to us
they are
having
all
shittier lives.
Shitty,
it also leads to us allowing neo-Marxists to go in and brainwash people.
They're basically the second
He starts to explain all these things, and he starts to basically say that like Western people
I guess the second
rate
to the Christianity would be Judaism, really. So you have Christianity, then you have Judaism, then you have Nietzscheanism. And I mean, is Nietzscheanism really all that different? Well, maybe I shouldn't get into that.
Having lower quality lives, that we're going on this downward spiral. So you combine this along with that movement that was coming with like Trump and all
like
that.
Speed this up.
And then you combine it with Jordan Peterson talking about this stuff, and it's this great awakening. And you start to look around and you start to study stuff and you start to learn many things that you probably shouldn't learn. You realize that maybe all is not well. Maybe the West is going through a deep, deep cascading crisis. And then of course, what happens?
Maybe the West is ran by... I can't say it.
Well, they come in.
No,
of course, for
I can't say it.
But then you're trapped inside and you're kind of thinking, I've never seen history.
Let's go. So true. So true, American creationist. So true.
Heard of the entire world having something like this happen. This is quite a big deal. And during that time, OnlyFans shows up and all the girls start to like strip down and do all this type of stuff. You start to notice just how deracinated and materialistic everything is. You start to realize that, you know, you're kind of scared. There's these like giant medical programs going on. Everyone's acting like a hoe. What's going on, lads? Something like this whole God is dead thing starts to hit with unimaginable force. All that stuff about the communist revolution and the communist takeover, and you see how politicized people are and how unconscious and NPC-like people are. You start to say to yourself, oh my God, is this really going to be it? Is this going to be like the West's Russia 1917 moment, where there's going to be this horrible takeover and then there'll be like butchery and death and struggle and all this? And it's scary, and it makes you ask big questions. It makes you ask stuff like, maybe this God is dead thing is really real. Where have we gone wrong? I walk outside my house and I walk through my town and I speak to people, and there's no consciousness anymore. You know, people are just reciting things they see off the news. They don't have personalities anymore. They cite, you know, these Reddit downloaded opinions like churches are bad and we are bad, Western people are bad, our culture is evil. This is like in Ireland, and we should just comply and go along with all this type of stuff, you know. And it just seems like there's no thinking happening at all. There's no mind anymore.
Uh-huh.
These people seem like they've been brainwashed to hate themselves.
Wow.
They've been brainwashed to be unhealthy, to be decrepit, to be some type of ugly bug or something like this.
It's because they have been.
And this hits you like it hits me like a train. It was really like the bringing down of an abstraction into a real idea in my hands. The God is dead idea. The arrival of the totalitarian psychosis, where the state imposes such madness upon people and people stop thinking for themselves. They lose their souls because God dies. And this is where I think an awful lot of people, many of my friends, many people like me, many people like us, turned around and said, wait a second, we need to start asking a serious question. Like, what is going on here? Because we need to start getting firm about where we stand, because this can't go on any longer.
Retard, no.
So it was around about this time
don't
that I noticed people
yourself.
Started to go
suicide
all in
is not the answer.
Either Christianity or Nietzscheanism, myself included. I was looking for something that firmly explained the world down to its very core. And many of us felt that Jordan Peterson was not succeeding in doing that. He had sort of laid a path for us to look at the world and understand the world. But this was not enough. You know, Jordan Peterson was not...
Is Silent Hill based? Silent Hill 2 is based... I don't know if Silent Hill itself is based.
Diving in the pool. He was dipping his feet in the water and calling it a load of archetypes. And a lot of people around about this point looked at what was going on and they said to themselves, you know, lads, we're either all in or not. Okay? So they would look and they would say, Jordan Peterson's talking about archetypes. They would look and they would say, this is not an archetype. This is not some blather of psychology. What's happening right now is the Antichrist's regime is being established on...
Exactly. Exactly.
This earth.
And of course, you know, Uberboyle, he's going to be like, well, actually, even though it's very clearly, it's literally the Antichrist regime predicted in the book of Revelations, that's actually, actually, that's not what's happening. Actually, Christianity is the problem. Fucking retard, dude. I'm gonna kill myself, bro. It's literally the Antichrist regime predicted in the book of Revelations. They're literally trying to make a one world new order, right? A one world order that's going to be ruled out of Jerusalem in the third temple, which is being constructed right now. Bro's like, actually, but he thinks he's based, bro. Like, this guy thinks he's red pilled. This guy thinks he like knows what's up, and he doesn't even know what's up. It hasn't even occurred to him what's up. He doesn't even get it, bro. This dude's so out of the loop. He's going to make a video saying Christians are wrong, become an atheist, and actually the Antichrist is like fake. The Antichrist is actually the good guy, guys. Actually, the Antichrist is the good guys. I'm Antichrist. Nietzsche's book, I Am Antichrist. Kill myself, bro.
On some type of intellectual mind game and all this. Look at what is happening. Look at the massiveness and extremity of what is going on. Look at the way that they are so anti-Christian. Look how firm they are in their anti-Christianness. They humiliate it in all of the Hollywood and all of the media. The government all make fun of it. People don't want you to say the name Jesus Christ. What is the one thing you can make fun of? You can't talk about any other religion because that's all inoffensive, but you can make fun of Christ all you want. You make jokes about him. You can say, oh, he should be killed on the cross as much as possible.
Yeah, and it says in the book of Revelations and in Daniel that the Antichrist is going to unite all people and all religions into one world religion and a one world order.
Yeah, well, we would do it again, people say. This is the Antichrist regime. People are running away from the churches, and the reason why we're in such a bad state is because we've abandoned not Christian morality, not Christian archetypes. We've abandoned Christ. Christ is the fabric that holds together the entire universe.
So true, everybody.
Christ is not an archetype. He's not a symbol. He's literally the spirit of God incarnate as a man. He is the logos that made reality. And when we stop worshiping him, we are literally worshiping chaos. And what happens is the world...
What the fuck are you talking about? Go kill yourself.
The world falls apart around us, and we get punished for it. Christ is the only path. The reason why Western people stood super dominant over the world, creating the best civilization to ever live in, with advanced medicine that can defeat diseases, with science that could take us all the way to outer space, with incredible civilization and literature, the reason why that happened in our culture is because we were a Christian culture, and we believed in Jesus, and we believed in the Logos. And what has happened now, this God is dead that we are seeing, is our turning away from God. God's right there. God's sitting there waiting. And what is happening now is, as we've turned away from him and we've embraced this transformation of the world, we are getting punished. Everything is falling apart. It is like we have turned away from the sun and we're starting to become pale, emancipated. We're not going out and ripping our clothes off and allowing the...
We're becoming emancipated.
...sun to burn us and tan us and make us jacked and handsome and strong. Instead, we decided to hide indoors. Go on Reddit. Go on and, you know, make our hair blue. Go on and...
Crunchy B-Roll says, this guy's on the right track. It appears he has the correct info. He's just reprobate. No, he's just a faggot. It's just a faggot. This guy's friends with Kaustin Alamaryu, BAP, and BAP is literally like a Israeli spy, like literally. And this guy is one of the most influential content creators in the alt-right scene. So you have all these people like John Doyle, the APU guys, and like many other people. I can't think of them off the top of my head, but like, you know, like your average like AF ripoff kind of guys who are like as edgy as AF, but they're like gayer. So like people like Uber Boyo, they're all influenced by this guy BAP. But like BAP, like I said, is literally a Jewish spy. So basically what's happening is BAP is running counterintelligence for the Antichrist against Christians. So he's an Antichrist agent who is running counterintelligence against Christians by keeping an ear out to what Christians are saying about like the end of the world and the rise of the Antichrist regime. And then basically he's like, so actually this is why the Antichrist is Christian. This is why the Antichrist is actually based. And so this guy, and so is Nietzsche basically. But it's basically just there's this guy, there's this community of content creators that are literally just regime talking heads, but they're, rather than Ben Shapiro, like, who's just like this like whiny gay liberal, or Jordan Peterson, a whiny gay liberal, like someone who's more palatable to, like, you know, these soy jack raised by their grandparents type of people. People like Uber Boyo and Bap is the regime talking heads, but they're directed at like masculine men and like these fascist type of people. And so Uber Boyo is basically like a Antichrist agent that is LARPing as a fascist neo-Nazi to try and convince fascist neo-Nazis that, like, being down with the Antichrist and getting the mark of the beast is actually awesome and cool. And I can't say as much as I want to. I've probably already said too much. This stream's going to get taken down probably. But, you know, like, that's Uber Boyo's whole angle. Can't even talk. That's Uber Boyo's whole angle. That's Bap's whole angle. Is he's a Jewish spy. Like, literally an Israeli spy. That is being paid by Israel to push pro-Israel opinions to fascist, neo-Nazi, Groypers are not fascist or neo-Nazi, but they're on the far right people, and convince them of the Antichrist positions. That's basically what they're doing. That's what this video is. So he's not on the right track. He's actually on the wrong track. He's basically taking conspiracy theories that are actually true, that there is actually an Antichrist regime, that there is actually like a one world order that's being constructed, that's going to unite all religions and all cultures, that's going to be ruled out of Jerusalem, out of the third temple. But he's trying to dissuade people from actually fighting against it by saying, well, actually, while this is happening, the Christian perspective is actually the wrong perspective to take on this.
And do all these weird stuff. Go on and listen to all this crappy music and be depressed. Go on and inject ourselves with nonsense, with all these like bad chemicals and stuff like this. And we're turning into bugs. We're turning into wretches, golems. We're like golem trapped away from the light of the Lord. We've turned away from the Logos on Christ. And now look at what is happening to us. We are turning into slaves. The Antichrist regime is being born incarnate upon this world. And we are willingly becoming prisoners in this regime, where we will have no souls. We'll have no way to stand up for ourselves. We'll have no culture, no personality. We will be ultimate slaves in Satan's hell on earth. And this is what we are embracing. And calling this an archetype is stupid. It is not an archetype. It is not a fucking joke. You're all in or you are not. What do you believe? Where do you stand? The thing that you lack is lack of conviction. This is your problem. You do not stand for anything. You are soulless. Do you want a soul? Do you want a creative outlet yourself? Do you want to have something that you can stand upon? Then invest in something.
Yeah, but the only way to get your soul back is to have Jesus free you. Whoever the Son sets free will be free indeed.
Something. Stand on something. Look with the logic of your mind. The second we abandoned Christianity, this is how we fell into this crisis. This is how we lost everything. And so what I noticed is many people, and I understand it completely, went towards Christ. They went...
But actually, you have to go towards the Antichrist. This guy. Oh, he's actually a deep, thoughtful philosopher. He totally doesn't have bad intentions, guys. He's totally not just trying to psyop you into being a faggot that shoves things up your butt. No, he's actually onto something. You shouldn't go to Christ. Go to the Antichrist. If you go to the Antichrist, it'll actually un-Antichrist the Antichrist. And then the Antichrist will actually become Jesus. Like, that's basically his fucking logic, bro. What a retard.
Towards Orthodox Christianity, because the Catholic and Protestant churches are weak, and they've bent to the liberal world order, if you will. they went to Catholicism. Some of them went back to Protestantism. Some of them sort of did their own Christianity, whatever. But they got back into Christianity in a real way. And Young and Jordan Peterson and all them stood as nothing more than a stepping stone. And I've noticed that anybody really, like, don't, the people don't really talk about Young that much anymore. And Jordan Peterson is like, he is what he is, and he's lovable, but he's not like, he felt like the center of the story back then. He had main character vibes, main player vibes back then. But now he's gone into it. He's sort of a side quest at this point. He was like a couple of levels in the video game previous. You know, we were past that. He's taken us as far as he could take us, but I don't think he's gone this far anymore. I think it's a level up now at this point. Now, there's a big issue here. This is where the big money note comes. And this is a great struggle for me as well. I'm sort of, in my spirit, wrestling with these questions myself. Because I don't think Jordan Peterson have the total explanatory power that Christian perspective has. That Christian perspective is just obvious. When you're just severe with it and you say to yourself, it is, this is what is this? It's not an art, it's the Antichrist regime. That's what it looks like. And
it's obvious, but you're going to reject it anyways.
Every level. That's what it signaled itself as. It
it's literally true, but we're just going to reject it because... Because Nietzsche's based Incel Mountain Chad. I hate this guy. Like, I hate this guy. I can't... It's literally objectively what is happening. It's objectively what is happening. But... Even though that's objectively what is happening, that the Antichrist is rising and we're like living through the beginning of the book of Revelations, this dude, for some reason, is hell-bent on preventing people from turning to Christ.
Waves to you and says, we hate Jesus. We hate Christians. Christians are, look, my clothes are ripping off. See, as I embrace this Antichrist energy, I start to strip like a degenerate. Boyo only fans coming soon. This is what they come. They signal that they do not like the Lord. The Lord is the one thing they want to eradicate. And so that total explanatory power is emotionally persuasive. And then even Jung said something, which I think is very important, because we're going to go into Nietzsche now, of course. Jung even said that Western people should be wary of listening to atheism or even Nietzscheanism, which we'll get into. Because for you to abandon Christ is very dangerous, because we all have this structure to our psyche. At the throne of our psyche, we have our religious messiah, who sits on the throne of our souls, is the self archetype, Christ, the religious messiah. For Muslims, this would be Muhammad or Allah.
No, it's still Christ. Christ, Jesus rose from the dead, dude. See, like, it's not about archetypes. These people just don't get it. It's not about archetypes. It's not about this, like, fucking nonsense. There was a guy who has been historically proven, if you do the research, it's provable. Jesus was a real person who died, but then came back to life. Jesus isn't just an interchangeable religious figure that can be replaced by a more culturally relevant figure depending on where you are, right? Jesus cannot be replaced by Muhammad. Jesus cannot be replaced by the Buddha. Jesus cannot be replaced by Krishna. Jesus is the only real human being who came back to life after he died. These Hindu gods are not even real people. Muhammad was a real person. We don't even know what he actually believed, and he didn't go to the afterlife and come back. There's a fundamental difference there between Jesus and these other religions. Jesus is not interchangeable. It's not that we need to let go of religion. It's not like we need to hold on to religion. We need to avoid letting go of religion. It's that we need to avoid letting go of Jesus. Jesus is the only person who could possibly know what the afterlife is like. Because he's been there.
And we in the West, this is Christ. And for us to abandon Christ, for us to say I'm going to become a Nietzsche cell, or I'm going to go and become some type of atheist or something like this, is the akin to detonating dynamite inside of our own souls. And for you to have the creativity, assuming that you even can replace Christ with something else, for you to even, if that's even possible, for you to have the creativity, for you to have the luck, the timeliness, for you to...
You can't. You can't replace Jesus with something else. Because Jesus is real. You, like, people just don't get it. Jesus is real. You can't replace Jesus with something else. You can't make up your own religion because your own religion is not real. Like, I just don't think people get that. If you come up with your own religion that theoretically fulfills the same needs which Christianity fulfills, it cannot do that. It would be impossible to truly do that, because what makes Christianity special is that it is a real thing, that there really is a God and there really is supernatural world. We do not live in a materialistic world. We live in a supernatural world. We do not live in a nihilistic world. We live in a world with meaning, in which all of our actions will be judged by our Creator. To live materialistically is pointless. Ultimately, everything that you will do as this Nietzschean Chad is going to be forgotten. The only reason we remember Napoleon, Napoleon's one of these guys that is like one of the original Ubermensches that I believe Nietzsche like cites. The only reason we remember Napoleon is because Napoleon lived 200 years ago. Are we still going to remember him in another 200 years? Another 300? Another 400? Are we going to still remember the based Ubermensch? His memory is going to get dimmer and dimmer and dimmer. But there is something that we know is true. And what this is the truth of the whole situation, is that there is a God. God is real. God exists. And all people are going to face God when they die. And God will not forget your actions. And he's going to judge you based on your actions. That's the only person who's going to remember your actions.
To have the virtues in place to do that is monumental. Christ had to take on the sins of the whole world. All of man's suffering had to be channeled through him, and he had to die by having his skin flayed off in order for him to achieve that status.
You can't do that, though.
Status within our hearts. The amount of...
You can't be... There can't be another Christ.
Suffering.
Like, that's how this is like what this retard like unironically thinks. Like, he unironically thinks that like Christ is just an archetype and that like anyone can become Jesus, right? You just gotta be good enough, and then throughout history, people rise up and become Jesus, become the Christ archetype. They achieve Christ consciousness, and then they become like this world-changing figure. And he thinks that like Muhammad is just another Christ consciousness figure, and Buddha was another Christ consciousness guy, and Krishna was a Christ consciousness, and all this.
Suffering, angst, pain, the amount of psychological, psycho-spiritual power that has been channeled into Christ is incomprehensible.
Like, what the fuck does any of this mean? This is not what Christianity teaches. This isn't even what the Bible teaches. This is like his like retard, gay, faggot understanding of what the Bible says. It's not about psycho-spiritual energy. No, it's about we all deserve to go to hell, but Jesus, who didn't do anything wrong, that was killed and was offered by God, not by himself, by God, as a sacrifice to forgive us of sins. So instead of us going to hell, Jesus goes to hell. That's what's happening there. It's not channeling psycho-spiritual energy to get rid of people's sin.
You to think that you can overcome this, that you can just drop him and not have to summon up the same quantum of power for you to confront, you are very mistaken. Nietzsche tried to do it and it drove him insane, did it not? He vibrated as the psychic energy poured into him, the closer he got to the question of what could we create beyond this, and it began to break him apart. Like somebody getting too close to the sun, he began to flay and be destroyed by this spiritual power he's getting close to. These are questions that you must ask. And so Jung said,
the spiritual power, no, there's only God.
Drop the symbol of the self. For us to try to abandon Christ within our souls is dangerous. We will lose our souls. We could turn into something quite ugly and shocking. We could turn into slaves if we're not careful. So Jung had a great warning about abandoning Christ. But this is a big problem because we have this guy, Nietzsche, and Nietzsche is the money note. Nietzsche's explanatory power is all-encompassing. Nietzsche was the man who Jordan Peterson referenced who predicted all this. Nietzsche laid the framework for how to get out of this situation.
But guess what? The Bible predicted it first, and it predicted it 2,000 years before it happened.
This me.
Nothing Nietzsche said is new. Nothing that Nietzsche predicted in his books, none of what he predicted about nihilism in the modern world is new. Uber boyo. Everything that Nietzsche said in his books was predicted in the book of Daniel that was written something like 700-900 years before Jesus, and then was reiterated in the book of Revelations, which was written like, I don't know, 30-40 years after Jesus.
Nietzsche stood at the top of Mean Mountain in the 19th century, and he looked out across the next 300 years, and he made some pretty astounding predictions. Now, you should always take people who can predict things ahead of time seriously, because that's the sign of intelligence and accuracy. It is unbelievably hard to call even small things, like that Michael Burberry dude who called the stock market crash in 2008. He's treated as a savant as a consequence, you know, the amount of intelligence and good judgment necessary to do this. Nietzsche called so many of our cultural institutions issues 100 years in advance, 150 years in advance. This should floor you when you actually understand what's going on here. I can't even tell you what's going to happen tomorrow. Never mind.
Yeah, and the Bible predicted it 2,500 years in advance. I think I'd rather listen to the Bible than fucking retard with gay-ass mustache. The retard with the gay-ass mustache who fucking died in a mental asylum. Died in a mental asylum after he worshipped a horse and, like, sucked its dick. Dude, we gotta listen to Nietzsche, guys. We gotta listen to Nietzsche, bro. Oh my gosh, bro.
Mind what'll happen in the next 10 years, the next 100 years for Western civilization is just.
What about the next 2,000 years?
On me, champ. I don't know what's gonna go on. I don't know what's gonna happen. And this goddamn incel, this German mustache man, pulled it off somehow with his nasty writings and all this. So Nietzsche sits down and says that Western civilization's God has died. And this is obviously a bad thing for a very important reason. And a reason that I don't notice people like Jordan Peterson bring up that often. This is related to the purpose of mythology, of stories, of religion, of culture. Nietzsche has a phrase where he says, "We have art, so we do not die of truth." Now, this is such a subtle and fascinating perspective where reality and truth and knowing the truth and knowing what's going on is not exactly congruent with succeeding in the world. Think about it, for example, the know-it-all nerd. Who is living better, the know-it-all nerd or the kind of like 40 IQ jock who ends up getting a beautiful wife, producing loads of kids, and getting for himself a nice job that makes him a decent wage, versus the know-it-all nerd who understands how all the nature of the world works, but he's broke, has no girlfriend because he's a weirdo, all these type of things? Who is achieving the goals of life better? In some sense, who could you say is even wiser? You know, even though the jock is only, he's a grug with no IQ, he is still achieving success and health and in some sense creating beauty and creating a future. Whereas the nerd is achieving none of these things. The nerd is a sort of theory cell. He's lost in the abstractions of his mind and ends up not achieving anything. So he's smart but not wise. He does not achieve the goals that are necessary. And what Nietzsche notices from this is that if we get too caught up in overthinking or pondering or perceiving into the world, it can lead to very demoralizing realities. You know, this is the idea of a black pill. The world is a very brutal, savage.
Unless you just believe in Jesus, then you can't be black-pilled.
Place. And it's incredibly hard for us to be honest with ourselves about how brutal the world is. It's hard for us to say that not everybody is equal, that there's winners and losers, that in order for us to eat meat, animals have to die. They have to go through suffering. We have to draw sharp objects across their throats and make them bleed out as they writhe in order for us to eat hamburgers that we only eat 2/3 of and then throw in the bin. It's very difficult for us to accept this truth. Yet if we do not eat the food, we will starve. We will run out of nutrients. We'll turn into vegans and turn into dorks. And this is not good. So we need suffering and we need pain in order for us to live. But this is so difficult to digest. It's so difficult for us to accept that truth. In fact, if we learn about this truth, this is where vegans come from, is that the second they come in contact with reality, they see what it actually is. And it shocks them so much that they start to try to stop it. They start to try to escape it. They start to try to break free from it. They start to say, no, I can't participate in this. They try to inviolate reality. No, eating animals must be wrong. I can't participate in murder every single time I eat. So I guess I must starve myself. I must stop eating real food. I must go and eat Soylent Green or bug burgers or something like this, because I can't let myself touch the food that is a damaged animal. And this is what Nietzsche is saying, is that the truth can actually demoralize and destroy life. Sometimes it's better that we don't know everything. Sometimes it's better that we tell ourselves pretty stories, like all the animals don't actually die. They go into this big magical shiny factory, and this is where we zap them up to heaven and they go live with God. And when you're talking to a kid, that's maybe what you need to say in order to get him to eat the food so he can become big and strong and become healthy and create beautiful children and create a future. And this is a difficult question, but this is the purpose of art and culture and myths and stories. In some sense, they need to be beautiful.
The Bible doesn't say that, though. You know what the myths in the Bible says? It says that man has dominion over the animals to do as he pleases with them.
Beautiful lies. Plato talks about this too. It's noble lies, magical myths, things that
the Bible is not a noble lie.
And this is such a fascinating idea, because you know Buddhism and Schopenhauer, they would all talk about this as well, that like these magical myths are delusions that our mind set up to get us there.
But yet the Bible works better than all these noble lies. The truth actually works better if you just believe God is right all the time, and God has determined that he made an order to the universe and we are to have dominion over the animals. That works a lot better.
Participate in reality when really reality is schizophrenic. Reality is evil. Reality is samsara. It is maya. It is horrible. It is something that you should not participate in. You should want to free yourself from reality and ascend into nirvana, where you're detached from reality itself, because reality is nothing more than aimless mincemeat grinder of suffering and pain. And if you participate this is wrong. This is an example of a religion that confronts reality, becomes blackpilled, and decides to deny life because it is so brutal, and ends up creating what Nietzsche says an escapist ideology, a nihilistic ideology. He accuses Buddhism and Schopenhauer of this, a nihilistic ideology, because what happens? They actually go and look at reality. They look at how animals are all getting their skin sheared off in order for us to live. They say that suffering is wrong. It can't be true. The stories that we tell ourselves, the art and the myths and the culture that we tell ourselves is fake and it is bullshit. And we must escape from that absolutely. We must definitely go away from that. And if that means denying life, so it is. And what do these guys do? They rationalize a way to stop participating in life. And then that actually kills people who believe in this. If you go and you become a Buddhist or Schopenhauer fan, you're essentially committing suicide. You're planning to convince yourself that life is evil and you must stop participating in this. And the only logical conclusion to this is suicide. And you actually see this in quite a lot of like Buddhist mystics and whatnot. They will do stuff like, and Hindu mystics, and a lot of people out east where they're very, very perceptive and have this very subtle and profound psychology and way of approaching this stuff. They will do stuff like starve themselves because they don't want to participate in the samsara of suffering. And Schopenhauer had many followers who ended up killing themselves. It was quite a common thing with him. Anybody who read Schopenhauer and blew their brains out, that tells you an awful lot about how black pill that man was. And this is what you need to understand, is that the truth can be so toxic, so shocking, so brutal, that it can lead to literal death. And Nietzsche calls this nihilism. Do you understand? Because it's a big important point. Now, what we have in defense against this is stories, is things that we tell ourselves to keep ourselves motivated, to keep ourselves hyped. It's like when you're in a bad situation and you say, we're going to figure it out. We're going to work it out. You choose to believe. You choose to believe because reasons bring relief. To live is to suffer. To survive is to find a meaning in the suffering, to find a dream that you can chase after. And so all...
And what dream are we going to chase after? We're going to make the Ubermensch, guys. Guys, the dream is the Ubermensch. We're going to like become the next step in human evolution. We're going to become the Ubermensch. I'm going to like lift weights and drink raw eggs. That sounds like great meaning. That's going to keep me going forever.
All civilizations have.
That's going to prevent the West from dying. Drinking raw eggs is what's going to stop the West from dying, guys. If we just drink raw eggs, everything will be all right. If we just lift weights, it'll solve everything, guys.
Myths. They have stories. They have some type of religious architecture that hypes people's emotions up and keeps them engaged with the project of life and helps them justify suffering. You know, for example, the Greeks had their myths. The Christians would tell us stuff like, you know, the animals are, we're God's people, and then the animals must die at our feet. The pagans would make you sacrifice animals to understand that there's some type of natural order in play which justified the suffering that the animals were being put through. All these fascinating ways that this stuff would happen. Now, Nietzsche points out that a profound thing happened in European civilization, where Christianity is a religion of truth. Now, that's kind of weird. It's kind of weird because most religions are, their purpose is to drive you towards success, and they're supposed to be mystical and life religions that just bewitch you into participating in life. You're supposed to get delusionally brainwashed by them and engage in life, art succeeding over truth and art pulling you forward towards living, because living is wiser and living leads to success and living leads to actually all the good things like beauty and culture and health and all these type of things. And that's, you know, that's basically life affirming, as Nietzsche would call it. But Christianity has got this profound focus in it, which is really heavily obsessed about truth, because we've got this one God who's this one reality, and we're the rational souls that go and seek to know this God. And this persuades us that there's some type of project we must engage on, which is in pursuit of truth. Now, what happens in Western culture is that we all focus on this. We all become Christian with the Roman Empire, and we set up this infrastructure of monasteries, and we all get in there like incels, and we all sit down, us Irish monks in our monasteries, as the Vikings come in and try to steal our knowledge. All these Icelandic motherfuckers, all these Swedish motherfuckers, they can keep on flowing in and like, give me your books and hail Odin and all this type of stuff. It's like, what do you want to do with the books? It's like, we want to burn them. We hate knowledge. We hate information. We're just these savages, you know. We want to go live butt naked in the cold fjords and on our weird longboats where we're eating shark liver. Yeah, all right, Vikings, whatever. Us Irish, us all demure Christians, we're hoveling in our little monasteries trying to study the truth while all this madness is going on. We're trying to figure out how to escape this samsara of Vikings and grugs, 40 IQ Vikings chasing after our books and stuff like this. And so all of Western Europe goes through this project where we focus on this abstract idea of finding this truth. Now, do you see the danger here? Because isn't Nietzsche telling us that the truth is an ultimate black pill? The truth is the worst thing that you can figure out. You can't handle the truth, man. That type of thing.
The truth is that there's a God that loves you. That's a black pill.
Basically, you know, some Nietzsche pretty much in one sentence. You can't handle the truth, bro. The truth, you can't handle it. German incel, big mustache. So,
if you can't handle the truth, you're just a faggot.
Nietzsche is saying that's a bad thing, and what we are doing is we're developing this religion that seeks after it. And what is born out of this focus, this monastic focus, this focus on the one God, is essentially our science, our noble and high and profound science in the West, which obviously is a process for discovering God, discovering what is true. This is actually what it starts as. Natural philosophy, the scientific method, was a procedure in order...
You know, what about that? What about instead of just, you know, telling lies, Uber Boyo, just lying to people... Like, you've admitted you don't care about the truth and you're willing to lie to achieve your goals. What about instead of lying to people, you just stop being a faggot pussy and you, like, accepted the truth that God's real? Instead of being a faggot pussy, you just, like, accepted the truth and dealt with it. What if instead of being, like, a faggot that hides in the bush when the spotlight shines for... on you to expose your deeds, you step out? What about that? Why don't you try that, Uber Boyo? Why don't you try that, Stefan? Why don't you try that? Why don't you try stepping out into the light and stop being a fucking pussy? All right, well, listen, man, I can't keep doing this, man. I can't keep doing this. This freaking video, bro. Boring.